Hi, I'm Alex, and today I want to talk to you about one of my favorite ways to fix your raw material, dovetail. Dovetails offer a lot of advantages over traditional work holding methods. Using a vise with straight jaws relies solely on friction to keep your workpiece from moving. You often need oversized stock just to be able to hold on to something. And if your material isn't very square, it can be impossible to get a good grip. Using serrated jaws like these can help, but they only work well in softer materials, and it's still possible to have the workpiece move around since the indentations they leave aren't that deep. Dovetail jaws use the same idea as these serrated jaws, but take it to the next level. By cutting an undercut into the raw material and having a matching undercut on the fixture, it creates a mechanical interlock that makes it much harder to pull this part out of the vise. So check this out. I don't even need to tighten this vise, and this part's already impossible to remove. There's still a little side-to-side action, which is why these dovetail-specific fixtures often incorporate a pin. This eliminates that side-to-side degree of freedom and perfectly locates your part. Keep your eyes peeled for these rotary-specific fixtures coming soon to Haas Tooling. Dovetails also offer a few more benefits. I can hold on to the bare minimum amount of extra material, normally less than an eighth inch, and the angle geometry wants to suck the workpiece down onto the top of the jaws as you tighten it, which ensures a nice, stable, rigid connection. Another neat trick I love about dovetails is that I can design my dovetails so that my workpiece sticks out past the jaws. This offers me more tool clearance to do fourth and fifth axis work so I can run shorter, more rigid tools. It's a win-win. All right, let's talk about how to design and cut your dovetails. You only ever want contact with the top surface of the jaws and the angled base. If the dovetail bottoms out in the fixture, it allows the workpiece to flex right here on the skinny part of the dovetail. You're also now driving a wedge into your jaws and could damage them. By leaving some clearance underneath the dovetail, it gets pulled down onto the top surface of the vise, and there's a ton of support to stop the part from wiggling. Any interference in the corners is obviously going to be a bad time, so be sure to compensate for the corner radius of your tool and any radius or flats on your jaws. Speaking of your tool, always use one with an angle that matches the angle of your fixture, typically 45 or 60 degrees. We have a variety of both solid carbide and indexable tools available on haastooling.com, as well as dovetail-specific jaws and fixturing. These serrated style jaws that come stock on our self-centering vices, while they don't have a true dovetail on them, have enough of a relief that you can definitely hold on to one, and it for sure increases the rigidity of the setup. I've had parts move using just the serrations, but they get locked in after throwing a dovetail on them. There's a couple of things to keep in mind when programming these cutters. These solid carbide cutters aren't designed to hog out a ton of material at a time. You should rough out as much as possible with a different tool, like an end mill or a shell mill first. Next, if you're taking multiple step overs, more and more of the tool is going to engage as you go deeper into the cut. So you want to reduce the size of your step overs to maintain the same cutting load. Once you're done cutting, the easiest way to measure these is to throw some small gauge pins into the dovetails and measure across them. We've made speeds and feeds super easy by having charts for all of our tools and recommended materials available on haastooling.com. But for those of you that like to calculate them yourself, base your surface footage off the max cutter diameter and the chip load off the smaller neck diameter. All right. There's one final thing we gotta talk about, and that's making sure we have enough support material to keep the dovetail rigid. If I cut a dovetail like this, but my finished part looks like this, you can see that I've lost almost all of the rigidity and support I get from the top of the dovetail. To correct this, we can either cut the dovetail narrower so that it's closer to the size of the finished part, or run taller stock and offset the part vertically so there's more material and structure left. All right, guys, that's it. Thanks for watching. There's been a ton of times where I've regretted not running a dovetail on parts, but I've never regretted taking the time to cut one in. See you next time.